So to create a job sequence, we need to just go to the file menu, say new, and if you go to jobs, you'll see the three kind of jobs that are possible within data stage, the parallel job, the sequence job, and the server job. Till now, we have been designing the parallel job. Today, we'll see what is a sequence job. A server job is the previous is a sequential job that was used in the previous versions of data stage. So if somebody is migrating from an older version to a newer version, they might still have some server jobs. That is this. That is why this option is still there. So today we are going to see the sequence job. So we just say new sequence job. And this will be a sequence job window. So we can see that in the background it says sequence. And now if we look at the palette, we have some general stages available, the annotation stages. And we have the sequence stages. Now these sequence stages are actually called activity. They are similar to the stages that we use in data stage parallel job. For a sequence, they are known as activities. So there are various activities that perform some specific kind of function. But the basic functionality of a sequencer is basically to group together data stage jobs, connect them in a logical order. So to do that, we can even just go here, click on the job that we want to use, and just drag and drop it to the sequencer window. Or we can go to the palette and select the job activity, and the job activity is the stage that allows us to call a data stage job and execute it through the job sequencer. So that is a basic stage that we'll be using in a sequence, because the primary purpose is to execute data stage jobs, multiple data stage jobs. So we can either just drag and drop, or we can use a job activity stage. So it says job activity. By default, it has taken the name of job activity 0. And if we directly add it from the palette, then we have another job activity over here. Now, if we click at this, we are directly drag and drop this job. So we'll see that particular job details are already present here in this job activity. So this is the general tab. This is a general tab. We can just enter some description, some logging text. So whatever we enter will be, it will be written to the job log, the data stage job log, whatever we enter in the logging text. So this is simple description. So we should give a proper name. So whatever is the job name, ideally we should give the job name after that. And then if we go to the job tab, then because we had already selected that data stage job, we already have that job name over here. It's not a multiple instance job. That's why we don't have any invocation ID over here. But then we have some execution actions. So by default, the action is run. Run means simply execute this job. If we click on this drop-down, we'll see that there are other options available. Run is simply execute this job. Reset if required, then run. So in the last session, we discussed that if a job is an aborted state and we try to run it, it will not run. We need to first reset the aborted job so that it comes back to its previous condition, or we need to compile the failed data stage job. Only then we can run it. But since this is a sequence, the action has to be automated. So the option is reset if required. So if it's an aborted job, it will reset the job and then execute that job. Validate only is validation is simply verifying that the connections, the data source connections that we have mentioned in the job will work correctly. So it won't execute the job. So if we just want to verify that everything is correctly set up, we can have the option as validate only, and reset only will just go and reset the failed job. It will not execute the job. So in most of the practical scenarios, our option would be reset if required, then run. And then we have this option which is disabled. So we'll see how to enable this option and what that option means. But below that, we have something called the parameters. So these parameters are the ones that were defined in the data stage job. In the job properties, we define some parameters that we use in the data stage job. The same parameters, we need to pass values to those parameters that we define at the data stage job level. So for that, if we click here, we don't have anything over here. We can type in a constant. We can provide some hard-coded values, but that is not what we'll be doing. We need to insert parameter. So if we insert parameters, I don't have any parameters created yet for the sequence. So for the sequence, I need to follow the same procedure. I'll just say okay. And I need to go to the job properties, go to parameters tab. So it has almost the same tabs on the job properties, and create the parameters that I'll be using in the job. So I'll just create some default parameters, let's say. And give them some values. I'm just setting them to empty. So I can create some parameters here. I can add environment variables if I want to. So the parameters tab of the job properties window is same as that for the data stage parallel job. Just say okay, go here. And we can pass those parameters here. So whatever, if we have given some default values in the data stage parallel job for these job parameters, we call it through the sequencer, and in the sequencer we pass some other values for these parameters. Whatever values we pass through the sequencer will be valid. They will override the values whichever are given at the data stage job level. So we have to be careful to pass the correct values over here. So we can just go here, go to the value expression, click insert parameter, and we'll have a list of parameters that we have defined for this sequence job. So now we have defined the job. There was no invocation ID. We have defined the execution action, which will be, in most practical scenarios, reset if required, then run. We don't have this option enabled. We have passed the parameter values. So you'll say okay. Now my requirement is basically that once this job runs, only then I want to run the next job. So I need to connect these together. So these will be connected same way through a link. In a data stage parallel job that defined the data flow, in this it defines the job flow. So now I have two jobs, the first job and then the second job. And my condition is I want that only when this job completes successfully, only then I want this job to execute. Otherwise, I want the whole sequence to abort and stop at the job one itself. So if I click again on this sequence activity, I'll have an option to define something called triggers. So now I have another tab. Because I've added an output link to that stage, I've got another tab that is called triggers. So I click on triggers. This is the link name. This is the output link name that I've attached to this stage. So this is DS link 2. There's something called an expression type. Again, if I click on this, I'll see that there are various options possible for the expression type. This is unconditional. Unconditional means whether this job fails or it executes successfully, the next job will be executed. So this is unconditional. There is no condition based on this job status. Otherwise, we'll see later, there is called OK. OK means if this job executes fine, then only the next job will be executed. Fail, if this job fails, then the next job should be executed. Warning is if this job finishes with warning, then the next job will be executed. User status is basically we can create our own variables. So we can use some variables. We'll see how we can use the variables. And then we can define an expression based on which the next job should be executed. And this is again custom or conditional. Here again, we can define some variables. So if we see there's an activity variable over here. So if we click on that. So basically we can define our own custom expression based on which the evaluation will be evaluated, the expression will be evaluated, and then based on the result, the next job will be executed. So this is the activity variable. What it is showing at the top is the activity name. So since for a data sales job sequence, a stage is similar to an activity. There is nothing called a stage. Everything is called an activity. So the activity through which we are calling a data sales job is known as job activity. This is the name that we gave to that activity. We have some options available with that, which are provided by data sales itself. So I can check the job status. I can check the job name. I can check some user status. I want to check the job status. So I can just click on that. Job status is equal to 0 or job status is equal to 1. So this is a condition that we'll be given, we'll be giving. If we want to say that the next job should run when this job has finished successfully, why we need to give a custom condition instead of using the default OK conditional expression type is because OK is when the job has finished without any warning. If the job has finished with warning, there's another expression type called warning. So sometimes the job might finish with warning. If it finishes with warning, there's no functional impact to the data as such. So we still want the next job to run. That still means that the job has finished successfully. So we can give a custom conditional expression type using the activity variable, the job status. The job status equal to 0 means that it has finished fine. The job status equal to 1 means that it has finished without warnings, with warnings. So in both cases, we still want the next job to run. So we can type a conditional expression like this, and this will mean that the next job should run. So this is the job that we directly drag and drop and define the activity. This is still a job activity stage, same activity stage as is shown in the palette within the sequence category. If we just pull the stage directly, then when we double click on this, again, we have to name it. So we'll name it once we define the job that we want to call. So the job name will be blank in that case. What we need to do is click here. So it will show us all the components in the repository and we can select the job that we want to call using this stage. And based on the job that we are calling, we should name the stage appropriately depending on the job that we are calling. Because the job status and all those activity variables are based on the activity name. So we should give it a relevant name, a meaningful name, so that we can use the job status correctly. So this is a basic activity that will be used within a sequence. We have many more activities that will allow us to define branching and looping and all those actions within the data sage sequence. So here we have all the data sage jobs that we have created. We have all other components as well. We can go to any folder and select any data sage job. So let's select this job, say open. So that job name will come over here. If it's a multiple instance job, then we can give an invocation ID as well. Again, we need to define an execution action. So we'll define reset if required, then run. There are no parameters passed because we are hard coded in the job. So there are no parameters defined. So we do not need to pass any parameters to this job. And we say OK. So this is basically we have to define the parameters within job activity. Now, an important part of a sequence is that if we run this sequence and we have, let's say, three jobs. We have another job over here that we are calling. So there are three jobs that we are calling through this sequence in a sequential manner. So we want the second job to run when the first job has finished okay. We want the third job to run when the second job has finished okay. Now when I run this sequence and the job two fails, let's say the job two fails. So So I fixed the job and I want to again run my sequence, but now I want to restart my sequence from the point where it failed. That means I want to run my sequence from this job. I do not want to rerun this job. So that is where the property of checkpointing comes into picture. Now, if we saw that that property is disabled. So we can go to the job properties. We can say at checkpoint, so sequence is restartable on failure. We can check this. We can say okay. Now, if I go back to this, it will give me an option to select or deselect it. So I always want to add checkpoint. But again, based on the requirement, there might be requirements where we want to restart the job from the first step itself, or we want to rerun some particular job every time the whole sequence fails. So based on that, we can define whether we want the checkpoint to be enabled or not. But in most of the scenarios, that is a big advantage of sequencer, because the sequencers will be big and there will be many jobs involved. So we want to checkpoint the run. So now, earlier this property was disabled. Now we have this property enabled. But we have to be careful. This says do not checkpoint run. But we want the checkpoint to be there. If the checkpoint is there, that means it stores the status till the point the job has run successfully and restarts it from there. So we want the checkpoint to be there. So we do not want to check this. We do not want to check this property. Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry, the seems to be a problem with the telephone, because for the past minute or so we've only been getting every other word from you. Is there a problem at your end, you know, or it seems quite slow on the update of the screen as well?
Is the screen fine, or is it only the audio?
The screen's been going a little slowly as well.
Okay. Okay, it probably the connection is a little slow, so yeah. On my end.
Okay. Sorry, that seems to be the problem, if it's a bit slow, because your voice is cutting in and out or being quite echoey. So it seems to be okay now, though, but if you just start again for about the past 2 minutes, that would be great. Thank you.
All right. Okay, sure. Okay, so any time my voice breaks, you can just stop me there and I'll try to reposition my speaker or something.
Thanks, that's great.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so I was saying that in a job sequencer, the important requirement is restartability of the job sequence. Restartability means that if we have three jobs that we want to run through the job sequencer, and my sequence fails at job number 2. Now I have fixed my job number 2. I want to restart my sequence. So when I want to restart my sequence, I do not want to run the job 1 again. It had already run successfully. I want to restart it from the job number 2. So when I want to restart it from the job number 2, I need to add checkpoints to the job sequencer. So checkpoint basically is storing the information till the point the sequence has run successfully. So if I add the checkpoint, it will store the status of the successful run of every step of the job sequence. So in that case, what we need to do is, so this property that we saw earlier that was disabled, the property said do not checkpoint run, and that property was disabled. But now we see that this has been enabled. So how this has been enabled basically is we went to the job properties. So this can be set at a job level. And we selected this option. If we did not select this option, that property was disabled. If we say add checkpoint, so sequence is restartable on failure. Now I select this property. I say okay. I go back to my sequence activity stage. I'll see that that property is now enabled. So that means I can add checkpoints to my job. So I want to make the job restartable, and there would be some scenarios where we want to run it again from the very first step, but most of the times we want the job to be restartable. because it won't be just three jobs. It would be a sequence of a lot of jobs, and we do not want to waste our time rerunning the job from point one. We want to restart it from the job where there was an error. We fix it, and now we want to run from that job itself and the following job. So we want the checkpoint information to be there. But this property, we have to be careful. It says, do not checkpoint run. So we do not need to select this. This says, do not checkpoint run, but we want to checkpoint the run. So we do not need to select this. We just need to enable this, and we just need to leave it as it is. We do not need to check this. If we check this, then it will not store the checkpoint information, and the whole sequence will not be restartable. So we do not want to check this. We want the checkpoints to be there. Yeah.
Sorry. I get why this is important. I'm just struggling to understand how this works. So, well, any of the job activities that you're performing, when you do a checkpoint, how does that work? Does it capture the transaction log for the database and allows you to do a rollback, or does it just not commit the roles to the database until the job is completed successfully and it can fire the records to the database? So I'm just struggling to understand how that works.
So this is not at a database level. This is not that a job has executed till a point and then it starts from that point. This is at a whole job level. So it will just store the information that job one had completed successfully, job two had failed. So now it will start its run from job two. Job two might have failed, whether this transaction was in the middle. It was in the middle of committing database transactions, but that action will be repeated. The whole logic of job two will be repeated. So this is at a separate job level. So it won't rerun job one. That is the advantage of this.
Okay, so if the job is processed, say, 50% of the records which are committed to the database, does it perform a rollback of those 50% of records, or does it have a transaction file that it works from and it just starts off where it left off? How does that work?
It won't perform a rollback depending on what are the properties set for committing. So if we have specified some transaction level in the database stages, we can specify a transaction level after each, let's say it's 2000 records. After each 2000 records, the operation will be committed. And if it fails at the 8000 record, those many records would have already been committed. So it doesn't roll back. Unless we have a specific after SQL defined that says roll back all the actions, whatever have been done. So it won't do that. It will update the records, and then some data correction activity has to be created that will rectify those records which have already been updated.
Okay. No, it makes sense.
Okay, so this is just one of the activity. This is the primary activity of a job sequence because it enables us to call the jobs. Now, another thing that we can have in this job activity is we can take out multiple output links from this job activity. So we can also define an action when the job fails. So when the job fails, usually there's an activity called the terminator activity. So we can just connect it to the terminator activity. This will be the failed link. So we need to go to the job activity again and define a trigger, which is for this output link that is connecting to the terminator activity. So we'll define a trigger. This is unconditional. We can say this is failed, conditional. So execution failed. We can just say okay, and when we define it as a failed condition or a failed trigger, the link itself would turn red. So by default, it would turn red. Now the options in the terminator activity is basically we can specify this, that if this job has failed, it will go to this output link, go to the terminator activity. So if there are multiple jobs running in parallel, do I want to send stop requests to all the running jobs and then abort the sequence and wait for all the jobs to get aborted? So we need to check this as well. Or we want to abort the sequence right away without sending stop requests to the other jobs. So they'll keep on running, only this job will be aborted. So again, practically, in most of the practical scenarios, we want to stop all the other jobs as well, which are running if this job has failed. Otherwise, it all depends. There might be a scenario where there's another flow going altogether, and we want to keep that flow running because this job does not impact that flow in any way. So we can have the other jobs running, which are running in parallel along with this job. Or we can have all the jobs which have been running. We can just stop those jobs. So we just need to specify these basic criteria. Do we want to send stop requests to all the jobs, all the running jobs, and we want to wait for all the jobs to finish, and then this sequence will show the status of aborted. So we can take out multiple output links from this job. We can define a link which goes and says that the execution has been completed successfully. Then what is the next job that we want to run? Or we can specify what happens if it fails. So mostly this is a general design that all the failed links will be ending up at the terminator activity. So this is again one other activity. Now there are so many other activities available. Let's see what they do one by one. So another important activity that gives a lot of flexibility to this job design is the execute command. Now, execute command is basically an activity through which we can execute a Unix command or a batch script. So again, we can just connect to this execute command. We just need to define whatever is the command. So we can define through variables, or we can define, we can point it to a variable with the command, or we can define our own command. So we can give the path where we want the command to execute. We can give. So any kind of Unix command can be given here. If you want to pass parameters to that command, we can pass parameters. We can define those parameters in the job properties at the sequence level. So all that option is there. So simply type a Unix command, any kind of Unix command. So mostly what will be done and where this can be used, there can be multiple users of this. One example is that if a source is a sequential files that we are reading through, then before we start processing, we want to, they have a landing directory or the staging directory in which those sequential files come from the source. We want to move them to a work directory. We want to process them and then move them to an archive directory. So all those kind of actions can be written to the execute command activity just by specifying the command. Whatever is the Unix command, we can directly put the command over here. So this will help us to execute any Unix command. That is what this execute command activity does. Then another important activity is a notification activity. So notification activity basically allows us to send emails. So the now in this case, the multiple links coming out of this, we can define both of them to execute. The trigger we can define for both the links as okay. So when this job finishes, both of these two jobs will start executing at the same time. So that is why in the terminator activity, we want to define whether we want to stop all the other jobs as well, or we can just stop the one particular job and let the other jobs run. So now in the notification activity, so notification activity, as the symbol itself shows, it's used for sending emails. So we need to define all those parameters over here, the mail server name, the sender email, the recipient email, the email subject, if there's an attachment. So attachment, basically, if you are on a Unix server, the attachment has to be somewhere on your Unix server. Whatever is the email body that we want, if we want to include the job status in mail. So we can define all these conditions. There is a default email format that is available with DataSage, that's available in one of the Unix directories where DataSage gets installed. So that can be used, or if we want to change the email format, we need to edit that format. So there's some default format provided that can be edited. It's just a file in the Unix, on the Unix box. All the other details, the mail server details, whatever email body we want, attachments, everything can be specified here. So again, if there is a need to send a mail, if one of the job fails, any notification needs to be sent, we can use this notification activity. Then another sequence activity is called the sequencer. So this activity basically, it can take multiple input links. So I can connect multiple input links coming from different jobs to this sequencer activity. And I can define an action on the sequencer activity. Can take an output link out of this. And the only option or action we need to define for this sequential activity is the mode. So there are two modes available, all or any. All basically means that if only when all the input links, all the data stage jobs which are called, or all the preceding activities which are getting linked to this sequencer stage finish okay, only then it will move on to the next job, whatever is the next activity connected to its output link. Or we can define this as any. Any simply means that if any of these activities finishes fine, this activity will be triggered and whatever activity is connected to its output will be triggered as well. So two modes we can define, all or any. We want to wait for all these activities to finish and then trigger the next activity, or we can just wait for any of these activities to be successful and then it will go and execute whatever is the next activity connected to this. We can also achieve a kind of looping through the sequencer. So looping is basically, we have two activities for that, the start loop activity and the end loop activity. So let's say I want to start my loop and I want to repeat this action again and again. So I start my loop, I want all this action to be repeated again and again, and then I want to go back to this. So this is my loop now. My loop starts from here, that means starts from this activity, finishes all these activities, goes to the sequencer, and this is the end loop activity. So what are the options that we can define in the start loop activity? Just click on this. We can define the counters. We can define a numeric loop. That means we can define a counter n to whatever. So we can define from, we can give it a parameter, we can pass it a user variable value, we can say from 1, what is the increment step I want to take, 1, 2. So for example, I use my execute command to find out the number of records in my sequential file and I want to process it those many times. So whatever is my requirement, I can pass this to this, or whatever it will be, some numeric value that will be there. I can pass it through a parameter. So I have all those, whatever the parameters available in my job, those can be used as well. So this is one way of defining a loop, a numeric loop. Define the lower value, the uppermost limit, and the increment limit. There's another option which is called a list loop. So list loop, basically, I can define some values over here. So I can define any kind of values. I can specify what is my delimiter here for each of the values, which it will identify based on the delimiter that I have defined. It will execute this loop. So the loop is basically whatever is between the start loop and the end loop comes within the loops. Those many times that action will be repeated. So we can specify a loop activity as well. Now there's another activity called the user variable activity. So if we just take an output link out of this, just click on this. So it shows we can create some variables to store some temporary values that we evaluate within the sequencer. So it goes to the user variable tab. We can right click. We can say add row. So a variable will be created. We can call it something. User variable one. We can define an expression. We have all those options available, which are available for a transformer derivation. So we can define any kind of derivation for this. Or we can define a job parameter. So we can, if we store a value of 4. So basically we'll define some expression, the output of which we need to define our loop condition. So we can store that value over here. We can say okay. If we say numeric loop, so whatever value, whatever variable we have defined, that we can use. In the stages within the sequencer. So this is basically for temporary storage of some value within the sequencer itself. So now if I am going to define a numeric loop, I have defined some expression within my user variable activity that evaluates to something, completes that value. Then I can define from one, step one, I want it repeated those many number of times. I can just click here. I'll get an option here. User variable activity, that is the name of that activity stage, and whatever is the variable that I created within that stage. So I can use that. That can be used as a parameter. Say okay, okay. So we need to connect that user variable activity to the start loop activity to be able to use that variable, or to any other activity stage where we want to use that variable, we need to connect the user variable activity stage. Then another activity stage that we have is called the wait for file activity. So again, this, as the name suggests, we take an output link out of this and double click on this. So wait for file, basically it will wait for a file to arrive. The file, whatever is the file that we want to specify this condition for, again we can give the path, whatever is the file that we are waiting for. So this is the file, whether we are waiting for the file to appear or we are waiting for the file to disappear. So those two conditions can be specified, can be used both ways, waiting for the file to appear or waiting for the file to disappear. And what is the timeout length? So what is the time till which I want to wait for the file? And again, these options, this, because we selected it in the job properties, now we have the option to specify the checkpointing at each activity level. So we can select it at that activity level. So whatever is the file, basically we need to wait for, we are waiting for it to appear. So it might be a control file, because that will indicate that a transfer has been completed from some remote server. So, and when that file appears, we can define whatever is the time we want to wait, whether we want to time out or not. We can say okay, and we can connect it to the next stage, which is used for the processing. So these are mostly the important activity stages which are available within the sequencer, and we can link together all these stages and define the control flow based on all these activities, the results of all these user variables that are defined over here, and we can define a control flow, we can define the branching and looping. So mostly when we have a particular process flow and we have multiple data stage jobs within that process flow, we want to define a data stage job sequencer. We want to link together all those data stage jobs through the data stage job sequencer. And then we have just this one sequencer. This can be saved in the same way. So this will ask us to save it in some directory. We can give it some name. And then we can, instead of calling each of those data stage jobs separately, we can just run this data stage job sequence and execute those data stage jobs in a sequential flow. Again, we'll not be doing it mostly practically through the data stage director. We'll not be scheduling the jobs through data stage clients. We need to use a ds job run command in the Unix shell script. We need to create a Unix shell script, use the command line, Unix command line command, which is ds job run, to run this data stage job sequence, pass all the necessary parameter values, the access, the user credentials for accessing the data, the ETL server, and then we can schedule that Unix shell script through any external scheduling tool. So the advantage of sequencer is basically that it provides us all these abilities to define the loop, to define the loops within different jobs, and to define the dependencies of different data stage jobs. So for one process flow, mostly we'll be going and creating one sequencer, and that one sequencer is the one that we'll be executing instead of executing the data stage parallel jobs separately. So any questions on